Hello and welcome to our video interview on Oncology Central today. Today we are at the Sanger Institute in Cambridge talking to George Vassiliou about identifying the genetic vulnerabilities of acute myeloid leukaemia. Thank you for joining us today, George. Could you tell our viewers about your career and what led you to where you are today?
Yes, I come from Cyprus and I came to the UK to study medicine in the late 80s, and I studied at the Royal London Hospital. Okay. During my medical student days, I was introduced to some interesting science, and I particularly liked hematology and diseases of the blood. And very quickly, whilst I was still a medical student, I decided that's what I wanted to do. So after I graduated, I did my registration, which is the mandatory sort of bit of medical hands-on training. And then I went straight into hematology and then got onto a training scheme in London. I became more interested in hematology and leukemia research in particular through working at the Hammersmith Hospital with Professor John Goldman, the late Professor John Goldman, and inspired me to go and do a PhD. I came to Cambridge for that, and I've not looked back since. I've continued to do research whilst trying to keep my clinical practice going.
Thank you for that. So what led to your specific interest in the genetics of acute myeloid leukemia?
So what acute myeloid leukemia is a particular disease I'm interested in, but there is a number of related myeloid leukemias that are sort of linked to acute myeloid leukemia, or they can sometimes come first and then develop into the acute myeloid leukemia. But what is most striking about acute myeloid leukemia is that most people who develop it, i.e. my patients, they're previously well. They haven't got really much of a period of unwellness, and they turn up sometimes extremely unwell very suddenly. Mm-hmm. Almost like a really bad flu, that you don't have it 1 week, you have it the next week. So that struck me, and I thought this cancer goes from nothing to something so serious so quickly. And of course the story is not as simple as that, but this is what struck me. And then I started to learn about the types of genetic changes that drive it, etc. And I felt, this is something I really would like to investigate, particularly in order to not only understand why it happens that way, but to develop one day effective treatments, because a majority of patients still do not survive this disease.
Thank you. That was very interesting. Could you tell us about what your research is focusing on at present?
So there are two broad areas, both related to acute myeloid leukemia and the related leukemias. One is how this leukemia develops. Essentially, the question that drove me into this is, why does this person turn up, having previously been well, with leukemia within the space of days, essentially? So it's actually understanding what led to that. And my group described a couple of years ago that actually the problem is brewing for many years beforehand, and it's just a final, let's say, event that turns it into leukemia. But the cells that were heading that way are present for many years, sometimes decades, and something happens. So we're trying to understand that, and we're trying to perhaps identify those that are at risk of going there and prevent that from happening. But also in particular, and more recently so, we are finding that as we age, as we hit the sixth and seventh decade, when the leukemia becomes more common, the changes in our body may invite the progression towards leukemia, may invite those cells to expand further. And we're trying to understand what it is in aging that makes it fertile ground for this leukemia. It used to be thought that it's just the passage of time and the DNA changes building up, but it's clearly more than that. It's clearly an interplay between an aged, let's say, environment in the body and these cells that are trying to become leukemia. And the other big interest in my group is finding therapeutic vulnerabilities of leukemia, or therapeutic targets, shall we call them, so that we can target directly and treat the leukemia. And in that area, last year and since then, we have been publishing some work of some approaches of how to actually go to leukemia cell and experimentally ask the question, what genes are you relying on to survive? We find those genes, we can then inhibit the function of those genes and kill the cell. Out of that research that we started relatively recently, we are already finding targets and we're already trying to develop new drugs that one day, hopefully, will be effective against leukemia.
Thank you for that. Could you tell us about what the greatest challenges in the field are?
So I can represent the greatest challenge in acute myeloid leukemia is that the last drug that is used currently in the mainstream treatment of leukemia was synthesized almost four decades ago. In fact, slightly more than four decades ago now. So this is the last new thing, the last big new thing in leukemia. That's a very long time. We have not been able to find anything as good as that drug, which is called cytarabine, by the way. So this drug, what it does, and is very tantalizing, in the majority of patients, the leukemia looks like it's gone, and it goes into what you call remission, but actually in the majority of those people, it comes back. So essentially, almost this drug, together with some other pre-existing drugs, even older ones, looks like it gets close to curing the leukemia, but it doesn't. There's a little bit of leukemia left, and it returns. So the field's efforts in, let's say, increasing the cure rate of leukemia is to get rid of those few cells, let's say, that are left. It sounds easier than you'd think, because those few cells are somehow invulnerable to these drugs. So this is the biggest challenge, finding what it is that allows those few cells to escape and boosting the effect of these existing drugs, giving them that little bit extra to eliminate the other cells that are remaining, the bad cells that are remaining. Of course, another challenge is to try and predict who is going to get leukemia. Thankfully, acute myeloid leukemia is not very common, but the related leukemias become commoner with age, and in an aging population, they're becoming more and more common. So the prevention side of things will come more into focus in a society where the population is aging. So that is another big challenge that we need to be prepared for that and try and find strategies to prevent rather than treat, because in older people, it's even more difficult to give strong treatments, and you'd rather prevent than treat the cancer.
Thank you. So what do you think will be the hot topics in hematologic oncology research in the coming years?
So the hot topics pertain to the big challenges, really. How do you cure leukemia? This is what a lot of people doing the type of research I'm doing are trying to achieve. And this may happen incrementally. We might increase the cure rate by a little bit, a certain percentage, or we might be lucky and find a big discovery that suddenly makes a step change and cures a lot more people. But I think we're looking for combination treatments, add new treatments to the existing ones in a safe way, because every treatment will have its side effects. When you've got a pre-existing treatment, then adding a new one may multiply the side effects, so the two together may have more side effects. So you have to find those treatments, introduce them safely, and test them. One other way that is being developed, and it was actually made the national news a year and a bit ago, is a completely new way of targeting particular types of leukemia, which is a technology called CAR T cells. You may have heard of that. Mm-hmm. So CAR T cells are a sort of clever way to send some lymphocytes in, some T lymphocytes in, to somebody's body. Maybe their own T lymphocytes, maybe somebody else's. At the moment, a lot of the approaches involve the person's own T lymphocytes. Take them out, you arm them, let's say, with a clever weapon that goes in and finds the leukemia cells and kills them. That is a completely new, innovative approach. The problem with it is you have to find something that's uniquely present on the leukemia cells, because if it's present on other cells, the T cells are going to attack those other cells and cause a lot of problems and damage. But so for some leukemias, that's ahead of the game, because the lymphoid leukemias in particular is slightly easier to find these targets. In the myeloid leukemias, a lot of the targets are also found in the normal blood-making stem cells, which you don't want to get rid of because you need them to make blood. So that's the problem with acute myeloid leukemia. It's too similar to those cells. So at the moment, we do not have those targets, and finding those targets is an important, challenge that we're going to be facing in order to adapt them to CAR T cell technology, or perhaps monoclonal antibody technology, an older technology that is also gaining ground recently. Immunotherapy may also come in, which is another big field of cancer research, into myeloid leukemia, but acute myeloid leukemia, although susceptible to immunotherapy, is not one of those cancers that are dramatically so. So we'll see what happens in that space as well.
And finally, do you have any parting comments for our viewers?
What I'd say is that the advances in a field like leukemia are taking decades, and they're taking dedicated researchers, and there's a lot of groups doing this type of research, and whole careers have been dedicated to this. And unfortunately, without that big change coming in, what has been happening in the recent decades is that the research community has gotten a lot of new ways for looking into how you treat, how potentially increase the cure of these cancers. And I want to believe that we're reaching a critical threshold where we have all these complementary ways for tackling these questions. And we need to use what we have to achieve our goal, which is to help patients to increase the cure rate, decrease the side effects. Now, to do that, we need continued research support. And I, just as other people in the scientific community, are currently concerned about research funding, particularly in the context of Brexit in the UK and its role in research. UK punches well above its weight in this type of research field, in medical research in general, but in leukemia in particular. And it would be very nice to have the support of existing bodies to help with research funding going forward over the next 1, 2, 3 decades. That is really the one thing that is at the back of my mind all the time, and of my colleagues.
Thank you for joining us today. Thank you for your time. If you'd like to see more videos like these and watch the rest of the videos in this series of the Sanger Institute, please subscribe below and register for Oncology Central. Please let us know your thoughts by commenting below. You can also tweet us at Oncology Central, as well as Facebook, LinkedIn, and Google+. Thank you for joining us again. See you soon.